God who evermore will be. He opened the prison door, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
Shelenberger, and I'm the director of the Academic Success Center. Today, our scripture reading is John 20, 19 through 29, and I'm going to be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Jesus appears to the disciples. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said that, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hand and put my finger on the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So I have a friend who at the beginning of the school year decided that she was going to look for joy. This was going to be the year where she embraced all the joyful things. And I really admired her in that effort, especially after the last couple years of the pandemic. Everything has been so hard and there's been so much bad news and difficult challenges that we've had to get through. And I thought, I can do this. This will help. Power positive thinking, right? And as much as I tried to do this, I wasn't very good at it. And I found as the year went on, it got harder and harder to find those moments of joy. And who could blame us, right? The news has gotten increasingly bad. You know, we're seeing everything from high gas prices and inflation to literally the atrocity of war as we watch what unfolds in Ukraine. And so how is it not easy to feel the burden of all those things weighing on us? And not only these big national or global stories, but things closer to home, you know, bad news that students are receiving and maybe experiencing in their own lives and you know, financial setbacks and deaths and illnesses. It's a lot to handle. As I've been thinking about all this, I came across an article in the Chronicle of Higher Education last week, and it was talking about student disengagement and what faculty are seeing all across the U.S. and how students aren't really engaging with the experience, both in and out of the classroom. This writer of this article also wrote a connected piece, and she interviewed some students to ask, "Why are you feeling this way?" And one of the quotes from the students really stuck with me. She interviewed a student at Doan University, which is just a small college in Nebraska, and the student said this, "I feel like everyone has their guard up right now about bad things happening again, or anticipating that once you get a taste of what it feels to be happy again, that it's all going to just be torn and taken from you." Yes, I thought, yes, I feel this deeply. I've gotten a chance to travel. My kids have done some really cool things in the last few weeks. And even in spite of some of this good things, I've had this skepticism. You know, is this going to last? Is this going to really, you know, keep on going in an upward trajectory? Or are there going to be, you know, bad news again and another problem to face and to deal with? And as I thought about these things, I was reminded of Doubting Thomas in the story that I read earlier today. You know, we get the good news, you know, Jesus is not dead, he's alive again, and the disciples are there to witness that, and, you know, they rejoiced, they were excited, they were celebrating, and they went and they told Thomas this good news, "Hey, Jesus is alive," and Thomas was like, "I'm not so sure about that, I don't know that I can believe you," and he said, "I need to see for myself, I need to experience this." And so we find a week later, you know, Jesus appears again in that upper room and comes among the disciples and offers them peace again. But then he directs his words specifically to Thomas and he says, "Put your finger here and see my hands." He says, "Reach out your hand and put it in my side." He makes a specific invitation to Thomas to really engage and to really experience this idea that Jesus is not dead, that he's alive, that the story is not just that, a story, but it's real. And of course, Thomas finally gets it, you know, and he says, "My Lord and my God," and he believes. And I feel like that I'm a little bit like Doubting Thomas right now, or like that student in the quote from the Chronicle of Higher Ed. I'm not sure if I really get it and I really believe. And so as Easter has passed and I'm kind of thinking about spring and what new things are coming as the pandemic tends to get a little bit better, we'll finish up the school year and look forward to summer. Where is Jesus inviting me in to experience this good news? What do I need to pay attention to? And what do I need to engage with and really believe? And I think there was a really good poem that invites us into this same idea. It's a poem called Instructions on Not Giving Up, and it's written by Ada Limone. She wrote it a couple years ago, before the pandemic, during springtime. And so I will end with that as an invitation to you to pay attention and to see what God is calling you to hear, to see, to experience, and to feel his good news. So, Instructions on Not Giving Up. More than the fuchsia funnels breaking out of the crab apple tree, more than the neighbor's almost obscene display of cherry limbs shoving their cotton candy color blossoms to the slate sky of spring rains, it's the greening of the trees that gets to me. When all the shock of white and taffy, the world's baubles and trinkets, leave the pavement strewn with confetti of aftermath, the leaves come out. Patient, plodding, a green skin growing over whatever winter did to us. A return to the strange idea of continuous living, despite the mess of us, the hurt, the empty. Fine then, I'll take it, the tree seems to say. A slick new leaf unfurling like a fist to an open palm. I'll take it all.